Carl and Lou here from Games, Brains and Headbang Live, GBHBall.com for sure. And you've seen the title, it is tier list time. We are ranking 30 female horror characters and their actors into this list, basically. A wide array, chosen at random, initially just 30 women that I could think of in horror, and then looking around a bit more for research of ones that I thought, well, they're quite, this film was quite popular or loved, let me put them in here and things like that. Not all of these movies I've seen. But of all these movies, one of us have seen. Like, that is a guarantee. There's nothing here where it's like none of us have seen. There was no point including that, because how could you judge the character? Yeah, yes. Absolutely. But there are one or two. Well, I know I haven't seen it, but I know you have. Yeah. So that makes that part. And of course, women in horror, you know, it's not as weird these days as it once was in regards to starring roles as protagonists and antagonists. Whereas once upon a time, they were victims, and that was predominantly it. You know, the term scream queen exists for a reason in regards to that. But, you know, the world is changing. And we thought we'd take a look at 30 women.
Perfect.
So we're going to start off with a random modern one. One that isn't like a character that I think is going to stay long in people's memory. Mm. Although that when you do watch it, you do get invested in the character. And it's Adelaide Wilson, played by Lupita Nyong'o. This is from the movie Us, Jordan Peele's Us. I've seen it.
Not seen it yet.
You've not seen it. Yeah, so this is the movie that's... basically about tethers, a mirror side of yourself kind of thing, and then rising up to try and take their rightful place in that story. I'm not going to get into spoilers about the movie at all, but so basically, Lupita, she plays Adelaide, who's the matriarch of this family, two children, and her husband, and so on. They live a very happy thing. She's always kind of got this thing about her where she remembers stuff from her childhood that kind of scarred her and things like that. And that was actually because she met a tether quite young. And there's a story in regards to that. But she also, I should say, Lupita also plays the second role of her own tether here. And the two very different characters as tethers are more feral. More feral and violent and aspects like that. So she gets to do both here, which is incredible for her. As the character Adelaide, not that memorable. Mm. Not that memorable. It's just she's a family woman. She's got some great stuff at the end of the movie. And some great reactions and behaviours and things that I quite enjoy. I can picture her quite clearly in my head. It's not like a long mainstay of a character.
No.
But because this is just me, I'm going to put a slate straight in the middle as interesting.
Yeah.
Okay, another one that's just a one movie character. Mm. And it's Amelia, played by Essie Davis from The Babadook. And so basically this is the mother of the film, dealing with a lot of things, not just the supernatural elements of The Babadook itself, but also the fact that she lost her husband. She's struggling to look after her kid, who is having problems in itself. It's a very layered and difficult character to play, particularly when you want to sort of look at the subtle and the what-ifs of surrounding The Babadook, whether or not you have that thing of how much of it is actually real supernatural and not just the part, you know, potential of a mental breakdown of a struggling mother.
I think she does a really good job.
I think she's brilliant, yeah. Because I remember certain scenes. I remember the police station scene where she brings in her, and you know, she's trying to sort of explain to the police officer, and it's about the book, and he's like, well, that book, and she's got it on her hands, and her hands have got like ash all over it, suggesting that she did burn it, and aspects like that. Obviously, you know, why can't you just be normal, shouting at a child, and aspects like that. It's some incredible stuff.
Because when you're watching the film, when the boy kind of kicks off and just won't calm down, we're kind of thinking it too when you're watching her. Like you feel for her because she's got a really tough situation.
Absolutely.
And yeah, I don't think anyone would be in that situation. She plays it really well, really, really well.
Yeah, this to me is one I do stands up quite strongly. Mm. I'm not entirely sure I'd put her in great because I mean the acting's great, but is the character great? Does it not deserve potentially to just go alongside Lupita?
Yeah, because same I think sort of thing. What she made of it because. Mm. That supernatural element, it'd just be a drama.
Agreed. So, it would be, yeah, it'd be a dramatic story about a mother struggling with grief and difficulties of a son and stuff like that.
And again, I think we're going to find that with quite a few of these characters. I feel like in their roles, if they weren't supernatural, they would just be... Does that make sense?
Yeah, it makes sense.
Some of the females are kind of like, they're still traditional female roles.
A lot of the time,
A lot of the time. But I think she does an amazing job, but... I wouldn't picture her character being anything. It's more what the son goes through, and she's just a vehicle to goes on what goes on with that as well. So I'd say interesting.
Same as well. Above or below Lupita? That's a difficult one because I put. Let's just put her alongside it and have the understanding that they're basically on the same level because you haven't seen Us, so it's harder to rank on that. Mm. Okay, this is one for me why I haven't seen, and it's been put in specifically for you. Mm. And the name Annie by Toni Collette from Hereditary. Hereditary.
That's a good
So
film.
Explain this one then.
So she's a mum with two kids, teenage boy, younger daughter, father. The mother was quite clearly a big influence on the family, and the film starts with her death. Annie makes, they're quite creepy, it's quite a lot of the part of the film is where she makes up miniatures for big companies, big people that want them, and small companies. And it's kind of like her path through grief and what goes on. I won't obviously again spoilers
of course,
for you, because
yeah.
I do feel like you should watch the
film. Oh, well, eventually.
So I don't really want to spoil it, but it's exhausting what she goes through. And kind of like the kids start mistrusting her of certain issues. And yeah, it's really, really good to watch. It just looks like she really put herself into this film. Like most films, she's good.
So that's the actor. What about the character, though?
Again, the...
Because when I think of what I've seen of Hereditary, her face does come into mind, but it's not what it was kind of pushed front and centre in regards to marketing and advertising.
I mean, obviously the film progresses, there's obviously more layers to what her
of
character
course.
Is. So I would put her top of interesting.
Top of interesting.
Yeah, I definitely would.
I mean, I'm going to go with it because I don't really have anything to go against, so...
This is the unravelling that puts her above the other two, I put...
Okay.
Yeah.
That's cool. Well, one we both do know, and it's another Annie. And this is Annie Wilkes, played by Kathy Bates, of course, of Misery. Now, Kathy Bates should need no introduction. You can see her in a wide array of different styles and movies. But when I think of Kathy Bates, I think of this.
Yeah.
I always do. It's almost, I picture her in the Annie Wilkes character more than any other movie I've seen.
And all the range of faces, I picture them.
Yeah, the wording, the calmness to the fury. Obviously, this is a Stephen King adaptation. It's obviously one of the strongest movie adaptions of his work. And it is. It's an incredible character from... Yeah, it's...
And another thing that I heard recently, there was an article about who was most believable as a psychopath... Sociopath. And which one played it the best rather than going over the top? So they said people like Christian Bale, that character, isn't. But someone like Annie Wilkes and the way that Kathy Bates played her totally is.
Okay.
Because I guess it's due to the inflection. So Kathy Bates goes from depression where she's not looking after herself to she's buzzing around and she's getting paper for him to write his book.
Yeah.
And the switch is the scariest part.
Yeah, it's not I get what you're saying. It's not just a switch from I'm happy 1 minute to I'm psychotic the next minute. Mm. There are other pits in between where she seems to sink into deep depressions.
Yeah.
Well, other times she seems to be elated to the level of almost why this elated about certain aspects. Yeah, I think it's an incredible character by an incredible actor. It's going near the top.
I think iconic. You just said you think of Kathy Bates.
Yeah, I do. Yep, that's it. Yeah, iconic. Yeah, it's an iconic character.
Yeah.
It is, absolutely. Okay, this might be, I'm not sure if you've seen these movies before, but this is Bridget Fitzgerald, the character Bridget Fitzgerald. Played by Emily Perkins. Do you know who Emily Perkins is?
Emily Perkins. The name rings a bell.
She's been in quite a bit as well. She's got quite an iconic look. But in this movie, I think she really is an iconic look more than anything else. This is Ginger Snaps.
Never seen any of them.
So okay.
Yeah, this is another one of your ones.
Yeah, I really... I'm not a werewolf fan at all, barring a few here and there. American Werewolf in London, Dog Soldiers. Mm. Those are the good ones. And I kind of avoided watching Ginger Snaps for quite a while because I was aware it was very teen-orientated and it had a lot of subtle... sort of messaging about basically puberty and things like that, teenage girls and things like that. But I actually found Ginger Snaps to be a blast. I had a lot of fun. I got well behind both the sisters because the other sister is in this, but we're just dealing with Bridget here more than else. But Bridget's sort of thing where she's I'm going to say it as it is in the film, the uglier of the sisters, less popular and all that, but it didn't matter in the early portion of the movie. They were still best friends. They were outcasts, even though her sister was far more attractive and stuff like that. They purposely made sure they weren't popular. So when Ginger, who is the other character, gets bitten by the wolf and starts to go for transformations and starts to recognise her own sexuality and stuff like that, it really hurts and harms Bridget in that aspect, but also her love for her sister when she realises she's in trouble and all that. Brilliant stuff.
Mm.
It sounds so strange, but like this one, I'm going to put in great.
Yeah.
Because if you've seen Ginger Snaps, I think like you feel like you know who Bridget Fitzgerald is. And Emily Perkins has done loads of stuff. She's a very, very good actor. When I think of Bridget Wilson, I think of this particular... I think of her face, her behaviour, This is some good. It's really, really good shit. Yeah, it's really good shit from her. For me, it's great. It really is. I know that might be like, that's a bit like putting her above the three that we've put in, but that's just, it's just a personal impact taste thing. Yeah. Another one everyone should know. It's Sissy Spacek. Mm. That's it, isn't it? Sissy Spacek playing Carrie White from, of course, Carrie.
Yeah.
Obviously, another Stephen King adaptation more than anything else.
Yeah.
So actor wise, obviously, Sissy Spacek. She's done quite a lot of stuff as well. I wouldn't say I know a lot of her work.
No. Now,
if you asked me to name 5 or 10 movies that Sissy Spacek has done, I'd start to struggle, you know?
Yeah, I really would struggle.
But I certainly would probably come out first and go, well, Carrie.
Yeah.
Yeah, like that. That's it. That's it. And it is an incredibly difficult role. Very, very unique stuff here. Obviously, it's kind of iconic elements in the movie. I don't know if I'd say the character's iconic. It's more the elements of the movie.
Yeah, because it's been done before with telekinetic powers and stuff like that. But
the way it's done?
Yeah, the way that Sissy Spacek does it, because it's weird because the sympathy at the end, I think I still feel sympathetic for it at the end. I know like the whole massacre thing.
You're supposed to.
Yeah, which I think she plays it really well because I think they cast her because obviously she's got quite an unusual look and that ties into what Carrie's supposed to be. Obviously in the remake, they picked
Chloe Grace Moretz.
Yeah. And she's, by most standards, very pretty. Obviously, once we go by Hollywood standards, she's very pretty. So
yeah, I get what you're trying to say. It's going to be a difficult one to sort of explain without it sort of sounding a little bit odd. But it's simply put, if you're going to create a character that isn't perhaps apparently considered an ugly outcast, then putting someone into that role who is, for anyone's eyes, can be like, well, that's an attractive character. And Sissy Spacek is an attractive character. You can see that with Carrie, it's certain elements and all that.
Yeah.
But they wanted her. She's very thin. She's very gaunt. She's got freckles. She's got a certain hairstyle. She's got no fashion sense. Stuff in school. Yeah. We've all been at school. We've all gone through this at some point in our lives where certain aspects of things you've done have made you unpopular briefly just because of how you dressed or what you did or spot or stuff like that. You can completely understand.
And I think they cast in that film, they picked girls who are like, on the other end. So
of course.
Template cheerleaders, just to kind of make that even more...
That's how it should be if you're going to tell that story.
Yeah. So like, I can't remember her name, but the one that plays like Sue. The one that plays Sue is like the other end, like cliche, what you picture as an American cheerleader, all-American girl. But yeah, come back to Sissy. Such a good way she plays it.
Yeah, other than the obvious ending, I always kind of remember the sadder parts regarding her and her mother and her innocence more than anything else.
Because her mum does a good job as well.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. I didn't want too many from one particular film.
I'd go for Great because she does a really good job.
Yeah, I'm happy with Great. Top of Great.
Yeah.
Yeah, top of Great. I'm happy with that. Well, we've got two of the same characters here, but played by two different actors.
Mm.
And we'll explain why. Let's start with the first one then. We will start with the original Clarice Starling, played by Jodie Foster, of The Silence of the Lambs. Actor-wise, obviously, Jodie Foster's done a great, immense amount of work. Couldn't, again, say if you asked me to name a lot of films, I'd struggle. Silence of the Lambs, Contact.
Bugsy Malone.
Right, yeah, when she was a kid then, weren't she? Yeah, so, yeah, but it's one that I've not really actively remember going, oh, look, there's Jodie Foster, that kind of aspect. Yeah, but I know her from Silence of the Lambs. And I like the character of Clarice Starling. Mm-hmm. I like the soft-spokenness. I like her her brain in the movie as well. And how but ultimately, what I always enjoy the most is that she's in a boy's world and she's trying to make it in a very difficult, difficult job. And she's dealing with some pretty horrific stuff.
Yeah.
And that's really, really cool. But I like the character a lot.
I think, yeah. I think Jodie Foster does a really good job with it. Like, she's in over her head, but she doesn't give up on it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it'd be easy. There's vulnerability to her. So it's not, like, completely unbelievable. Like, she just goes in there and it's like a montage in an American sitcom where she just does 180 and she's...
No, God almighty,
has like a makeover and comes back in and she's all sassy. It's just, she knuckles down, she's hard working. That's why she gets recognised in the first place, isn't it?
That is.
Because of she can work hard and she's got guts and stuff like that. I think it's a very strong like female character. And again, like you said, like in the male world, and you see there's like...
There's lots of really clever subtle shots where they show you the difficulties of this small petite woman as well.
Yeah.
And this what is predominantly... the lift scene is iconic for that specific reason. Obviously, she gets in a lift with her other trainees.
Yeah.
They're all massive men. Yes. She's a small petite woman standing amongst them. You know, it's one of the shots like that.
I think my one is when She's trying to get the police to clear out. They're all like effing it, not effing and jeffing, but like joking around. She wants to clear him out the
funeral. Yeah, that's right.
It's
yeah.
Like, yeah, it doesn't have to be like waving a banner going, "Get out! I'm in charge now." It's just like, no, I'm going to take control. This is what I want to do.
You are right about something as well. The movie would not have, her character would not have had much impact if by the end it was all about, oh, look, now she's this spunky badass.
Yeah.
And like, you know, like the captain's taken his hat off and gone, well, you proved me wrong at the end and yeah. stuff like that. That doesn't exist in the movie, thank fuck.
Yeah.
It really doesn't.
It kind of, it links into the whole bleakness of it. It's just it's a hard world.
Mm.
And she works hard in it. I don't know, it sounds really shit, but... Yeah, well, I think it's an iconic character. I feel like it's...
Ooh.
I think it's Clarice Starling.
Oh, the problem is no, I was about to jump in and give you a reason as to why I can't put an iconic.
She catches jizz in her face, man, and character doesn't like put her off becoming a police officer.
The reason why it can't be iconic is because ultimately what iconic character came out of our movie ahead of her?
Hannibal.
She's great, but I'd put her in between Carrie and Bridget.
Okay.
I think Carrie...
I wouldn't have any lower than that. But
no, yeah. I wouldn't. Yeah? Yeah. Well, below Carrie, you agree?
Yeah.
Yeah? I think so. Mm. And the other, Clarice Starling. This is Julianne Moore's version in Hannibal. I'm going to be pretty mean here. Don't care for this version at all. And the reason I don't care for version is it's kind of what we just said about Jodie Foster's version. This is an older, more experienced Clarice.
Mm.
So that's fine. I can live with that. Mm. But it just doesn't feel right that she's this... tough, no-nonsense badass that's still able to be manipulated by Hannibal. Really bugs me to a massive degree. And I really, really have a problem with that movie early on. I mean, it's more of a plot thing, less about the acting than anything else. You know, the whole she shot a woman while she was carrying a baby.
Mm.
And then we just gloss over the fact that that same woman who was carrying a baby also shot her with a machine gun.
Yeah, it's a real big point.
And it just sort of makes you think, God, this is stupid. Yeah. Like, this is stupid. But the whole, like, I'm just a badass now. And now I'm being wronged by my own department. It just doesn't work. I've never really rated Julianne Moore as an actor either.
I quite like her.
I'm trying to think of something else I've like can really remember that she was good in. Because I tend to think of things like The Lost World, and I think the movie sucks.
Yeah, no,
and
not that. Boogie Nights.
I've never seen Boogie Nights, so
she does a really laid character in that.
Well, you tell me, what do you think of this version of Clarice?
So I like Julianne Moore as an actor, and I feel like the script, that really bad plot point of she kind of gets demoted and suspended because of that.
He shot a woman who was carrying a baby, even though that exact person just shot her with a machine gun. It's so absurd.
Yeah, and I think that stuff, it just like tries to hammer home, oh, the guy, Ray Liotta.
Yeah.
That whole element of it as well. I think it just kind of gets hammered home too much. Whereas in the first Silence of the Lambs with Clarice Starling, it was subtle in Hannibal. I mean, I've read the books, but I can't remember if they did change anything.
Well, Hannibal is absurdly over the top. There's nothing subtle about that. Think about the interactions between Jodie Foster's Clarice with Hannibal and Julianne Moore's interactions. Can you remember any of their interactions compared to Clarice? And I've seen, you know,
it's mainly over the phone, isn't it?
I end up thinking of shit like that and like... Mm. How he can, like, literally be there and no one catches him, even though it's, like, an old, you know, it's just so silly. Yeah. I remember Hannibal more for the strong parts, which involves the French, the Italian cop and stuff like that. I ended up blanking out a lot of the stuff with Gary Oldman's character because we're doing a judgment in a film here. I want to kind of focus on the character more than the other. I think because it's the same character, you have to have some comparison.
Mm.
So you can't just go, well, no, let's just ignore what was done. It's a different version. It's like, but it's not.
No.
It's Clarice Starling and it's Hannibal World. All it's, like in that movie, the events of the Silence of the Lambs happened. Mm. These are the same characters.
Yeah.
So although, you know, it's a different actor for whatever reasons, is it a better version? No.
I don't think so. I think Hannibal covers more, that does more to do with like pride and things like that.
Yeah.
There's a lot of kind of what to do with pride. So like the whole thing, Gary Oldman is about pride, about what Hannibal did to him. Ray Liotta being overcome by a woman's character. I feel like that's, they're trying to kind of show that the male characters come off worse through their pride. But at the end, like Clarice ends up letting him go.
Yeah.
And things like that. And it's just like, I don't know. I find it a difficult film. Especially after the sort of Silence of the Lambs, I think Red Dragon's better.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Yeah, this is of the three original Silence, Red Dragon, Hannibal is the least of the worst of the three.
I feel I'd say meh.
Meh. Yeah, exactly what I was thinking.
Yeah.
I think it goes on meh.
Yeah.
Okay, this is one for you, because I know I haven't seen it. And this is Danny by Florence Pugh from the movie, forgotten the name of it.
Summer, what's it called? Midsommar.
Midsommar.
Yeah.
Midsommar, yes. Yeah. So this is Danny, the main girl, I believe, Florence Pugh. I've seen a couple of clips. Looks like she does the role quite well.
She does a really good job.
Yeah, but I guess this is one for you. You tell us why and where it should go.
Oh, so the film is another one. I think it's the same director, isn't it? Same director as Hereditary.
It is, yep.
There is links to it. The film's absolutely mental, but I really enjoyed it. Because it was something so different for me. I really enjoyed it because it wasn't just usual. It starts off...
Unless you see things like The Wicker Man, then it may not have the same level of originality, I think.
Yeah, I've not seen that. Yeah. But I did like this film. The film starts with a pretty tragic start, which is kind of, obviously, this is why Danny... So, her sister kills herself and the parents... So, she has a lot of family tragedy.
Mm.
Her friends, and I think it's a boyfriend. I've watched it quite a while ago, so forgive me. Take her away to this festival, this place, you know, which kind of like a gap year kind of thing.
Gap year. Yeah.
And obviously it all kind of goes, starts off quite subtle and ends up going completely...
It's a cult, basically. Yeah. It's a cult, yeah. Basically.
Yeah. And I think she does really well because obviously at the start she's just pretty much just not there. She's grieving. So yep. she's just there in shell. She's not actually there.
Yeah.
And then she kind of gets on, but she kind of has to kind of go through the experience of it all. I think for a young actress, she does a really good job. I would say... I've seen other people going through grief, things like this, so I wouldn't go anything above interesting.
Okay.
But I still think she does a really good job with the role.
Well, a lot of our sort of one-time roles are in interesting, yeah, so it belongs along there. Fit. Where does it... Where in interesting do you put it?
Bottom of interesting.
Okay.
Because I won't remember her name of her character.
Okay, that's interesting.
When you said Danny, Florence Pugh, I remember the actress more than the name of her character. And I was like, oh yeah, cool, she's the main one where her sister and her family,
That's cool, yeah. That's cool. I have nothing to add to it, I haven't seen the movie yet. Right, here's one for iconic, maybe even the top, maybe unbeatable. And it's one everybody knows, it's Ellen Ripley, played by Sigourney Weaver, of course, of the Alien franchise. Sigourney Weaver, I should definitely need no introduction. Yeah. You could probably name X amount of films off the top of your head immediately that she's been in. But of course, she has made the character, the all ass-kicking character of Ellen Ripley, an iconic horror movie character from the early version in Alien. That's a little bit more fearful, a little more scared, and dealing with that one individual alien to the badass ass-kicker in Aliens. And of course, the tired but still kick-ass person in Alien 3. I know the character takes some difficult directions in Alien Resurrection, and you know we can have it, but at least it's a different version of Ripley. I mean, you say Ripley to anyone,
they know
yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, I think you know exactly who that is.
Yeah, they can picture an image.
You can picture a line.
Yeah,
you know, get away from you, bitch. You know, yeah. Alien Queen fight.
They've not remade any. They've not kind of recast.
No, that's either. Yeah. This is like a safe one.
They got her back for, was it Resurrection? Was the last one Resurrection? The last very last
one?
It was like
ages and ages and ages ago, you know.
But they didn't kind of get anyone else in or do anything to that character and write it differently.
The Xenomorph and Sigourney Weaver, like, they go together, you know. They really do. It's that kind of aspect. I mean, it is such an easy character to rank, I think. I think it goes top of iconic.
Yeah, definitely.
Simply that. It really, definitely. Really does.
Yeah, because I always thought, like, Sigourney Weaver, she never... overacted it, or like it was really subtle. Again, she was in a male dominated world.
There's lots of stuff like in the first one, there's not much of that. In the second one with the Marines and all that kind of aspect, there's some great shit that she does with them. When I think of Ripley, I always think of when she's rescued Newt and she ends up in the Queen's nest and like she's threatening the eggs to keep the aliens at bay.
Yeah.
And she has Newt, and it's not going to be easy to walk out of there, but she still chooses to stop shooting up the eggs and blowing everything up. And it's just like, oh, God, you're a badass, man. Yeah. Like, you know what this means.
Yeah.
Like, you know, you knew we were going to be difficult to get out alive anyway.
Yeah.
Be like, well, fuck it, I'm going to try and destroy you all. You know, that aspect is fantastic. Yeah, I love the character. It's top of iconic. Of course it is.
Definitely.
Okay, we're back with Ginger Snaps. And this is for the other iconic character. It's Ginger.
Devil's sister.
Played by Catherine Isabel. Catherine Isabel has done loads and loads and loads of work. You've seen her in many, many different horror movies across the years. This is Ginger. This is the one who will become a werewolf. I kind of gave you an insight into her already. She's sisters with Bridget.
Yep.
She's the prettier, more noticed one by the boys, that kind of aspect. But she doesn't care for that. She sticks by her sister, who's a bit more of an outcast. And they cause a lot of problems and trouble. But Ginger does eventually get bitten by a werewolf. And then that sort of her transformation is initially slow as she sort of, basically it's about reawakening of sexuality, teenage girl finding herself and all that. You know, she starts to go to school, starts to be hit on by boys, enjoying the attention. Some of that isolates some of Bridget, but of course she starts to become a werewolf. In the picture I've chosen, that's after she's killed someone and she's giggling about it. Mm. And of course, you know, the very ending, obviously, between her and Bridget when she's fully transformed into a werewolf. It's a good movie. I don't remember Ginger as much as I do Bridget, because Bridget's got such a unique look. That's what it is, Emily Perkins.
I'm intrigued on this film now.
But Ginger, I'd put her alongside it after Bridget, basically. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a couple of Ginger Snaps. There's a sequel called Ginger Snaps Back, Ginger Snaps 2, Ginger Snaps Back.
Oh, okay.
And I can't remember much about that movie, but I remember the third one, which has them both playing the same characters, but like hundreds of years before.
Oh, okay.
Which I quite like the idea of, you know? Because it's kind of like, well, these are the characters. Why not just use them again, you know?
Oh, that's
a bit. This one doesn't have a character's name because it's the actor's name. It's Heather Donahue from The Blair Witch Project. Now, take this. I don't think it's necessarily fair to judge acting here to a degree because this movie was sold and it would obviously next to no name people in roles, so you're not going to get great acting chops here. Likewise, it was supposed to be more realistic, so they were going to have more realistic kind of behaviours and stuff like that. There's an argument to say that doesn't always happen. But do we... Heather. I mean, when you think Blair Witch, you think Heather. You think of her screaming Josh over and over again. You think of certain things. You do, you know? Yeah. It is quite... It's quite a rock. Is it a great? It's not a great character. It's just a normal person.
Yeah, she was quite driven. Like she did seem like she wanted to get all this stuff, you know. And that's what I think that causes arguments sometimes, isn't it? Like she wants to push on, and you know. And I quite appreciated that.
Yeah.
I think all three of them had their like roles to play, but Heather, because obviously you've got the iconic, like, that's not seen, obviously that's parodied quite a bit.
You're up close crying to the camera scene, you should know alone.
Yeah.
It's difficult to rank because it's there isn't really a character. It's just a woman, a person.
Yeah.
Who ends up in the woods and gets lost, just a person. As a character, tell me anything about Heather that you don't already know, like in the movie. Like, tell me anything about her background.
No.
Nothing.
And I think I don't feel individually for all three of them, I want them all to get out of that situation, like, none more than the other. I mean, I had the Matt guy that kicked the map into the river.
Josh. Oh, it doesn't matter. We're talking about Heather anyway.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But, I'd have to go with top of me.
I just don't think there's a character there. No. I get why, but ultimately, it would, you know, how could we put.
This is a film where in the woods.
Yeah, I'm going to put above Julianne Moore purely because I really don't like that version of Clarice Starling.
Yeah.
So it's simple as that. Yeah. It's more of a personal tasting than anything else. Okay, here's one I don't think you know. You'll know the actor, but you will not know this role. It is Danielle Harris.
Oh, I know.
Obviously the iconic Scream Queen, but when she was a youngster, playing Jamie Lloyd in Halloween 4 and 5. This is when she's quite young. I think maybe around 11, 12 years old. She's Michael Myers' niece, and Michael decides to set his targets on her. Confusingly, they would end Halloween 4 with a suggestion that she had become like Michael Myers and then drop that angle in the next film completely. You know, apparently killing her parents with a pair of scissors was fine-ish. She ends up in a hospital.
Yeah.
But they kind of gloss over the fact that, you know, she went a bit stabby with knives. But it's Jamie Lloyd, and I absolutely love her in these movies. It's one of the things I always remember her out, particularly when she tries to appeal to Michael's, like my uncle's side of things and aspects like that. It's the first sort of movies I saw with Danielle Harris in. So I really, really liked the role. I put it in interesting, not above, just because you know Danielle Harris, and then you're like, oh, what, she did these movies when she was a kid? Yeah. That's really cool. I want to see them, you know?
And because she wasn't there from the start, it's kind of like, oh, Halloween 4 and 5, if you haven't seen...
Oh, they're bad movies.
Yeah.
Overall, they're bad movies.
And not like you go, oh, yeah, she was in the Halloween series. No, she was in, like, 4 and 5.
Yeah, and so. The teenage version of her in number 6 would be somebody else. Yeah. And she'd be killed off quite quickly anyway, spoilers.
So, again, the whole arc of the actual character itself had lots of holes in the plot.
Yeah, it always absolutely. So, had they continued the idea that they had ended number four with, we could have had a really interesting thing going into number five. We didn't get that, unfortunately. But she's incredible in it. Number five in particular, her facial reactions when she's having... Because she loses the ability to speak for a while, and her facial reactions when she's having the nightmares because of her connection with Michael. These movies are weird and confusing. Halloween, man. It's interesting, but I'll put it bottom of interesting, yeah? Because there's a couple in there I can't really decide if it'd be more, you know, that aspect. Jennifer Hills, played by Camille Keaton. Of course, this is the character from I Spit on Your Grave, the original one. Simple enough, it's the only movie I know her in. Yeah. I can't think of anything else, or I'm even aware she was in anything else. And it was an incredibly difficult movie for her to be part of. Obviously, it's a video nasty, or was a video nasty, with a high level of sexual abuse. And then, of course, the revenge angle that she takes, using her sexuality as a weapon rather than as a victim kind of thing. You can have your pros and cons for that story. That's not what we're here for. The role and the acting and stuff. It's a great, great performance because she has to go through a lot.
Yeah, and you feel like you go with it because there's no one else. Because there's no one else that you're focused on.
Yep.
It's all Jennifer.
Yep.
That's a really strong, to be able to carry a film and to be interested and invested in behind his character is a big ask.
Yeah.
I'd go great.
I'm happy enough for great because particularly I think when she starts to use her sexuality as a weapon, I think it's some of the best parts of it because she was it's like, I'm not going to be a victim now and I'm going to get my revenge and I'm going to use what they used against me almost.
Yeah.
You know, I really like the final shot as well. I like the fact we didn't have it dragged down. It's just driving off in the boat and that kind of aspect. You don't see her breaking down and start crying like, oh, you know, it's still the stern-faced, stoic stone, you know?
And you kind of think, what's going through her head? Like, what's going through her head right now? But she just doesn't really show it on her. She doesn't really show it on her face. And like you said, like, it's just, she
had, it just had to be done.
She had to keep moving forward, which I think is a good way that, I like the fact that the ending is, there's movement in the ending. So it's like she's moving forward rather than just being static in one place.
Yeah, I'm happy with great, but the end of great.
Yeah, definitely.
This is a difficult one, but I thought it was the character that most stood out in the movie. This is Black Christmas Remake, and it's Olivia Hussey's Jess Bradford.
Do you know what? I barely remember.
Okay, her boyfriend's did piano playing and that aspect and things like that. She's basically the final girl of the movie aspect. I mean, the fact that you barely remember anything is not a good thing. I mean, can you see the picture? Does that ring a bell?
No.
Okay, that's Olivia Hussey's done quite a lot. So, again, it's an actor that does a lot of things. It's very easy to get behind Jess in this movie. She's someone quite likeable and quite, not wouldn't say layered, that's the wrong word, but quite got a little bit more depth than a lot of the other characters in it. It's someone you kind of want to see survive these events. And I kind of enjoy, put this way, when I think of Black Christmas Remake, aside from the bright colours and some of the deaths, I tend to think of Olivia Hussey.
Yeah.
But apparently you don't.
No.
That's interesting. Okay.
Yeah, like I couldn't. Yeah, maybe if I watch the trailer again, I'll be like, oh, yeah, that one.
But yeah.
I kind of, nothing really stood out to me. Like, if you're saying Black Christmas to me, I would think of,
bear in mind it's the remake, not the original.
Yeah, no, if you were doing Black Christmas in general, I would have gone with, the one was in Superman as well.
Oh, the original.
Yeah, Margot Kidder.
Margot Kidder. But we're not doing the original.
I know, that's my point of
I did say this was 30 random.
Yep, my point of comparison, I would, can't remember at all.
Right, well then that means she has to go on meh. Or not meh, yeah?
Yeah.
She can't go on bad. I don't think we'll be putting anybody in bad, to be honest.
Bottom of meh.
Fine. Even though I think she probably could go top of meh, but that's fine. I'll accept it, because you don't remember anything.
No.
I wonder if you're going to remember this character then. Juno, played by Natalie Mendoza from...
The Descent.
Descent. Yeah, so Juno is one of the spelunkers, one of the people that go in the caves, but she's also dressed up as a kind of villainous character in that she was having an affair with the lead, a husband, and that's kind of a thing at the end. She ends up, you know, what happens at the end of that movie. Juno's got a little bit more badass about her and stuff like that. I chose Juno. I actually chose two from this movie, but Juno and the other one. But Juno first. I really remember Juno. She really stands out for me. She's got a really cool look. I like her action. Like, she takes a lot of action, but obviously, she's got a little bit more layer as well, because there's the whole thing about when she, you know, sees her friend get her throat ripped out. And while she isn't actually dead, she then leaves her and says, she's dead. And later on, it's like, oh, you didn't see her die, that kind of aspect and things like that. I don't necessarily agree with that, but...
That they made her as a kind of brash American character for a bit of contrast.
Yeah, true.
Because the rest were kind of quite laid back, normal English. I can't use the word normal. What's the word?
Standard English.
If you're thinking like a sort of a film about women going away, that kind of thing. That's what the kind of characters were and the accents they had. And then you got this American coming in and is like, hey, you know, come on, get on there and like. And it kind of makes more sense. You do get a lot more extreme sports. I'm guessing you get more extreme sports.
She was a leader. Jenna felt like a leader.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And her energy was good, things like that. So yeah, I do definitely remember Juno.
Yeah. Interesting.
Yeah, I don't know.
I think bottom of interesting.
Yeah, I think the affair thing was a bit.
We needed someone to dislike.
We needed someone to dislike her. I mean, it could have been that she kind of left someone behind on another trip or something, or someone got injured because of her not caring or something else. I felt like the affair was a bit jammed in to make the other character even more sympathetic as well.
No, I agree. I agree. Because yeah. We'll get into it. We'll actually go straight to the other one, which is Sarah, played by Shauna McDonald, who is effectively the lead in this movie. She's the part in the beginning with the car. Her child is killed in an accident. And then obviously her friends rally around her and take her spelunking to help her kind of distract her from the aspect and stuff like that. So Juno's having an affair with her husband. Sarah she's not a particularly interesting character. She's got those layers of sympathy and stuff like that. But you can't. I always struggle to really get behind that. However, I like her toughness that grows throughout the movie. Certain aspects. There's some amazing shots in Bournemouth when she comes out of a pool of blood, the feeding area, and the toughness there to her, you know, leaving Juno to die, to work at the end of the movie, and all these other aspects. It's not necessarily, again, that memorable. And here's the thing. We are focusing on Descent, but the Descent 2 undoes a lot of work of both these characters. And the reason why I chose these two characters out of the entire cast of The Descent, which is all female-based, is because both these characters return in the sequel.
Yeah.
And that was the extra layer there. Taken in the sequel into account, I think their stock drops a lot.
Yeah.
I think it drops a fucking lot. But for me, I'd put her alongside Juno.
Yeah.
But I put her below Juno.
Yeah, because Juno had that bit extra of vigour about her. Yep. I mean, we are watching Sarah on this trip after all that she's been through. So we just take that into account that Juno...
She might be a bit colder.
Juno's having fun. Juno's having an affair with a married man. She hasn't got that responsibility of being a grieving husband or like a grieving wife or a mother to a child that's been killed. So there is that comparison. But
she might be more mentally shut down. I completely get that. But overall, I think they can sit alongside each other. Yeah. That kind of thing. But when I think of The Descent, I tend to think of Juno first more than anything else. I like the name Juno as well.
That's a really cool name, yeah.
Kirsty Cotton, played by Ashley Lawrence of the Hellraiser movies. Yeah. So the very first Hellraiser, Hellraiser 2, and is it number 5? Can't remember. Hellbound? It might be Hellbound.
Oh, actually. The husband.
No, not Hellbound. That's the second one. Hellseeker? Mm. Yeah, that she returns for that. Mm. When I think Hellraiser, she's a major one that jumps to mind when I'm not thinking about Cenobites. It's Kirsty Cotton. We've done so much about her already, you know. I think Ashley Lawrence does a pretty good role. Mm. It's not always the best acting, particularly in the first movie. There's some sort of cheesy lines here and there and things like that. And it's the whole thing where it's like an older than teenage daughter... Daddy-in-law, my daddy and stuff like that. It's where you're just like, oh, that's just weird.
She's only a child, though.
Yeah, but still. But then, like, I like how in the second film, she's become more accepting of the situation and she starts to use the power of the Cenobites to get her own way. Then I really like the wrinkle when she returns in the later movie and her setup of her husband.
Her wing,
and stuff like that. There's some cool shit with her.
There's some cool shit. Yeah. I'd always pick Julia over her.
Yeah, I mean...
just because I think she gets more memorable stuff. Maybe she gets more extreme scenes, so that kind of always stands out more to me.
Of course. Probably going interesting again, isn't it?
Yeah, because again, she's just... Take away the supernatural element. Nothing really stands out.
As a character, you're right. Yeah. Like, what is it? I'm a teenage girl who loves my dad. In the first film. In the second film, all her character stuff is based around the events that occurred more than anything else. I want her to go high in interesting. I kind of want to put top of interesting.
Yeah. That's a fair compromise.
Because she's in several movies, you know, and it's a pretty famous franchise.
Yeah.
It's an iconic character. It's Laurie Strode,
Yeah.
Jamie Lee Curtis. Of course, the Halloween franchise.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's Halloween, Halloween 2, Halloween H20, and briefly in Halloween Resurrection. And of course, in the Halloween 2018 movie, Jamie Lee Curtis has been in, I don't know how many movies. Mm. So many movies, not just horror either. She's a character, an actor who can do a wide array of stuff. She's fantastic. You get excited when you see her name that way. And as Laurie Strode, it's fantastic. I mean, from the very first film to this innocent girl who isn't like the others, so she's not trying to sleep with boys and stuff. Yeah. It's the whole, you know, it's very final girl stuff, you know, and her war with Michael Myers into the second movie where that war continues. And then obviously the things like H20, where she's the school teacher and she's got a little more badassery about her, to the rubbish that's the Resurrection. She's only in for like 5 minutes because she had to be, to the new Halloween and all this. I mean, the character, it's synonymous with Halloween. It is, again, you think Michael Myers, you kind of think Laurie Strode.
Yeah.
You definitely do, you know?
Yeah, I'd go iconic.
Below Sigourney Weaver's, yeah?
I'd say below Annie
Wilkes. Oh, no way. No, come on. No.
Okay,
below Ripley.
Yeah.
But above Annie Wilkes, man. Come on. That's crazy talk. Crazy talk. This is Lorraine Warren, played by Vera Farmiga. Farmiga.
Oh, yeah.
So this is actually an actor playing the role of a real-life woman. Lorraine Warren, one of the Warrens, the paranormal hunters. Take what you will of that. Excuse my sarcasm. I just don't buy into that shit. Of course, this is the Conjuring universe that she plays the role. Now, I can't compare it to the real woman. I don't know.
I've seen biographies.
Yeah, I've not seen lots of anything about that. So we're just going to judge it on a character standpoint more than anything else. And Lorraine Warren, as Vera plays her, is so likable.
Mm.
She's so likable, caring, loving, decent.
Yeah, she always feels like she kind of
wants to help. Yeah. Like, wants to help. What's the film where they it's The Conjuring 2.
Yeah.
Where they know they're in trouble if they continue to help this family. Like, it's going to affect them more than anything else, their own child. But she can't quite say no because of the kids.
Yeah.
Like, the aspect I really like. Mm. I mean, we know as a couple, Patrick, what's his name? Who plays the...
Patrick Wilson,
who plays what's his name? Something Warren.
Oh my God.
I've forgotten his name. Yeah. Anyway, the husband.
Yeah.
They're a great couple. They got great chemistry. They're really, really likable. Perhaps they push up that to the limits, I think, by the time you get to like the Annabelle movies and stuff. And it's like, okay, nobody is this perfect.
Yeah.
That kind of aspect. But she's really, really likable. I like the fact that she stands up to a ghost. Her dealings with a nun is kind of cool. I like the character and I like the acting. Problem is, I don't like the movies they're often in a lot of the time.
Yeah, that's the problem.
But let's try and isolate that and just say, look, when you watch her, do you enjoy watching her? I really do.
Yeah, because come across as very sympathetic and and after all she's seen, it's not kind of hardened her.
Mm-hmm.
So she's still caring and compassionate. It's not kind of turned her to this like...
Yeah.
Well, because obviously she gets paid for doing this. It's her job.
Mm.
But there's more personal elements to then walking away from jobs and stuff like that. So
I think she's gone great, bottom of great.
Yeah.
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 When you think of The Conjuring, highly likely you end up thinking of her and Patrick Wilson.
Yeah, and she is, and her role is paranormal investigator.
Yeah.
So it's not outside of, it won't become outside of horror films.
Mm-hmm.
So she's linked intrinsically to horror films. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm happy with that. Janet Leigh's Marion Crane from Psycho. Now, this is simply iconic as a role for the pushing of things. So the time this movie was made, a woman had never been in this kind of... Or hadn't been... Women didn't really do roles like this, where they were thieves and sneaking around.
Yeah.
And also, where it seemed like... This is no spoilers, because you should know the spoiler from Psycho, anyway, but also sneaking around and seeming like you're the lead character who then dies.
Yeah.
Gets killed like halfway through.
That's
something really, really cool. Of course, she's involved in one of the most iconic horror scenes ever, which is her death inside the shower. I mean, that alone there to me kind of makes...
Iconic.
The scene iconic. Character, though, there's the problem. So, you know, she's just a bank teller who basically has to cash some checks, decides to steal on a runoff.
Yeah.
And she ends up, while trying to leave state, ends up staying at the Bates Motel. And obviously, the rest is history.
Yeah.
That is that. Problem is, if you just say to people, name me who that person was in Psycho. they wouldn't be able to name her.
No.
I think a lot of people wouldn't be able to name her. Might be able to name the actor, because Janet Leigh is obviously famously the mother of Jamie Lee Curtis.
Yes, yeah.
So there is that thing as well. But I don't know if many people really remember Psycho for her. It might be able to remember the scene. It might be able to go, oh, yeah, but could you tell me her character's name?
Yeah.
Marion Crane.
I'll go for great then.
Oh, nope. No. Too high. That doesn't, doesn't belong. Great. If you think about who's there, it goes in interesting. And I kind of want to put, and I'm going to be fair, realistic about this. Top of interesting then. Yeah, top of interesting. Because of what? It's impact more than anything else. Yeah. You know, it'd be weird putting it below. Nancy Thompson, played by Heather Langenkamp. Not in Elm Street.
Yeah.
Nightmare on Elm Street 1, Nightmare on Elm Street 3, and Wes Craven's New Nightmare. Heather Langenkamp has done roles elsewhere, but to be honest, it's Nightmare what she's remembered for. In the very original one, Nancy's likeable enough, but I don't think Heather Langenkamp is particularly brilliant in that movie. There's some pretty clunky, poor dialogue. Yeah. But I do love her fighting back at the end. It's very easy to get behind Nancy. Heather Langenkamp in Nightmare on Elm Street 3 is fucking brilliant.
Yeah.
Love her in that. Love the fact she comes in harder, tougher, and aware, and trying to help these kids.
Yeah.
Amazing. And Wes Craven at New Nightmare's angle, while a flawed movie, the role of having her playing herself is something I just think was really cool nuance.
Yeah. I really appreciate that. I'd feel a lot more films try to do that now and kind of steamroller it and go too much of it. But I did really like her character. And the development as well. As she gets older, it's felt quite natural as well.
It does.
So.
Great or iconic?
Great, because in the scheme of things, she's teenage girl.
Yep.
If it was outside of that and just go through normal teenage troubles and things like that. Iconic. If you think in those films, you might think of Nancy.
You might think of Freddy more than anything else,
And he's got so many different victims.
Yeah.
She's like recurring.
But she's the most. If I was to say to someone, okay, you got Nightmare on Elm Street, put Freddy out of your mind, but tell me the most famous Freddy Krueger victim, so to speak. Or like person he dealt with, because she, you know.
Nancy. So great.
Top of great, above Carrie?
I think in between.
Above Starling, Clarice, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's a fair point.
I think that's good. Pamela Voorhees. Played by Betsy Palmer. One and done. First movie only. And you only see her at the end of it when she kind of reveals her face. Because obviously that movie famously led you to believe it was not going to be Jason's mother. It was, you presume it's Jason all the way through, but it's not. It's Jason's mother. She's quite iconic for that alone. Everybody kind of knows that sort of tidbit, the whole like thing. As a character, you don't see enough of her.
No.
You know, she explains her motivations to the final girl at the end, and she does the whole speaking in high-pitched Charles voice kind of thing before getting her head chopped off. That's about it, really.
Yeah.
Iconic, but again, not necessarily iconic in the sense that everybody knows Pamela Voorhees is the villain of the first film. You know, that's about it. There is not really a character here.
No.
She's just the mother of Jason.
No. Yeah, it's a brief flash of her just to set things up.
So it's got to go on Mare, innit?
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Top of Mare.
Yeah, because
it still makes an impact.
Yeah, top of Mare, I think so. Yeah, absolutely. Linda Blair's Regan, or Regan. Of course, this is The Exorcist. Yeah. And, well, I mean, if you want to do it, it's The Exorcist 2 as well. But let's just talk about The Exorcist. Let's not do The Exorcist 2.
Yeah.
Just The Exorcist. It's iconic, of course it is, and it's a real challenger for the top. Obviously, you know, Regan is this quiet, innocent, young girl, then to lead into the initial problems where, you know, she just seems to be ill, to her eventual transformation into being possessed fully, and her behaviour throughout that. I mean, Jesus Christ, is it incredible stuff from this actor.
Child actor.
Incredible stuff.
And I always wonder, because I know when I read trivia, how they film certain things so the kids are not obviously scarred by it, and obviously when they can't watch films that they're in, the end product, because obviously seeing it all together would be horrifying. There's some quite, obviously there's some bits that have been cut, it's quite intimate stuff, not the language she uses, what she actually does and stuff. Like, I wonder how they kind of put that, how they did that. But her performance is amazing, because when she starts, it's not over the top twee.
Yep.
Like, she's not an idiot child. Like, she sees her just a normal child.
Yeah.
And then what she goes through, you kind of go through it with the mum and the daughter as
I
well.
I think you follow along to a degree. I think you do follow along to a degree as well. Mm. It is an iconic. It's just where we put it, an iconic. Now, I know I want it.
Oh.
I want it in between Laurie Strode
and Annie Wilkes.
And Annie Wilkes.
Yeah, I'm happy with that.
Yep. Because I'd argue that a lot of these women, barring Annie Wilkes, are on par. I actually feel like Annie Wilkes is too high now. I'm beginning to think she's moved on the top of great, but...
No. I'm definitely going back on it.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine. Mia Farrow's Rosemary from Rosemary's Baby. I'm not a big fan of Mia Farrow. And I didn't really think I'd enjoy Rosemary. I don't love Rosemary's Baby as much as some others do.
No.
But when I did eventually get around to watching it, I found I did actually quite enjoy a lot of it. I liked the subversion. I like the confusion that surrounds Mia Farrow's character here, Rosemary. I like the confusion where it's almost like she's constantly gaslit, whether it be by her neighbours, by her husband and stuff like that. I like that element a lot. I like her eventual acceptance as well and sort of commitment to things at the end of them. I really like this role. I just don't really care for her character overall. It's just the problem. I like the role, but as a character, I'm not like, oh my God, Rosemary, what? That's one of my favourites. No.
Yeah, no, I'd go for meh.
No, better than meh. Interesting. Yeah, okay. Interesting. And I think middle. I'm looking around the middle and I'm thinking, right. I'll put it after Florence Pugh's Danny character. Rand, just jam it in there, really, because it's hard with the interesting characters. They're all kind of on the same level, so to speak. Sally Hardesty, played by Marilyn Burns, from the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, effectively our final girl. If you've seen the movie, you know you're going to get a lot of screaming from her.
Yeah.
Sally's quite likable. She, you know, her brother, obviously Franklin, she tries to look after him, and all that, he causes a lot of frustration and stuff like that. You get behind her survival. You feel good when she kind of gets out of this one alive.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, because when you first start watching it, you think, no one's getting out of this alive.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I really liked her character. The scream pops, she's a victim.
Yep.
But the fact she gets away.
I like the fact that she just goes running and jumps straight out of a window. I love the fact that we have if your life is in threat, to the level that it is at this stage for her.
Top window as well, isn't it?
It's like, fuck this, I'm going out that window. There's no stopping and trying to open it. It's just straight through the window.
Yeah.
I love that. That's desperation.
Yeah.
That's great. I think great.
Yeah?
Yeah,
bottom great though, for me.
Yep, I'll go with it. I'll go with it, I'm happy with it. Cool. Fine, okay, four more. Sydney Prescott, played by Neve Campbell. Of course it is Scream.
Mm-hmm.
It's the Scream series across of it. I think the problem with Sydney Prescott is that as a character, there becomes zero development across the movies. What once starts a quite interesting subversion of the whole teenage girl thing, just like the whole Scream was a subversion of horror, I think by the time you get to Scream 3, it's the same old. There are elements I like in the sequel about her learning. For example, I really like in Scream 2 when it starts with her getting like that, what's his favourite scary movie?
Yeah.
And she reveals who's on the other line. And she shows that what she's got since the first movie is a way of tracking who's calling her and stuff like that. Like that. It's like, oh, you're learning. You picked up. You've learned this. You were in this horrible situation and you learned from it.
And
you know?
She's like, she can be on her own. Like, she can live on her, like, she's got the extra measures, but she's on her own still.
Mm-hmm.
She's just living with it.
Yep.
Obviously, it's still difficult and stuff like that. But yeah, I think sometimes it's Scream. The other characters, I find myself more entertained by. Sometimes we have a wet weekend. I know it's like...
Well, the question comes to how much do you like Neve Campbell as an actor? And I really couldn't really tell you much on screen.
Craft, that's about it.
I know, yeah.
So, I can't remember much. Again, same kind of character for me, from the films I know her from.
All right, where does she go then?
I mean, she's pretty... She's like... Scream.
She's Scream, she is in it,
But I just wish she had a bit more... to her. Like I said, sometimes
I would like more to her across the series. I'm happy with what they do with her in the first film and to a degree the second. It's more long term. I mean, I'm trying to see. The problem is when I think of Scream 3, I really struggle to even remember what the kind of her role was in that.
Yeah.
Okay. Does it go interesting, meh? Great.
Bottom of interesting.
I think it should be higher if it's going in interesting. Okay. It should be higher than the girls from The Descent. You know what I mean?
Above Daniel Harris?
That's why I'm struggling.
Yeah.
No, after Daniel Harris, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, that's the kind of middle ground. Yeah,
because she's like, she's a teen girl, and a scream queen, but compared to other ones, I get behind the other ones more. Yeah, overall.
Okay. This third last one, you're not really going to know. This is Syl, played by Natasha Henstridge. Now, of course, Syl was played by other actors later on in the movies, but I'm going back to the very first Species for this. And this is Species, where she plays the alien woman kind of thing. Now, let's be honest, a major part of this role was simply, you look good without your clothes on. Take them off.
Yeah.
Because this alien Syl wants to procreate, so it's a lot about sex and stuff like that. Okay. But I really like, what I do like is when she's a woman and stuff like that, how she uses that sexuality to her advantage. It's very easy, but she also seems very disconnected. Well, necessarily it's like an incredible, memorable role. Mm. But when I do think of Natasha Henstridge, I do think of Syl.
Yeah.
I have seen all the Species movies. I can't really tell you anything great that comes on afterwards and stuff like that. I don't think the first Species is that good of a movie.
Yeah.
But it's kind of cool. It's kind of a cool role for her to be in. It's not a great character because ultimately, as an alien, she doesn't say much. She's just simply about wanting a mate, and that's pretty much what she does. Yeah. I'm not wearing any clothes. Sweet. You know, that aspect, that's the kind of thing. You can kind of say, well, it fits in the movie because she wants to procreate.
Yeah.
So she's not, like, trying to be subtle. She's not trying to flirt. She's not doing anything like that. It's like, boing, and the men are like, oh, you know, that kind of thing. Yeah. That's what that aspect is. All right, it belongs in meh.
Yeah.
Right? I'll put it in meh, and I'll put it bottom of meh. Yeah, it's got to go bottom of meh. Because it is just a sexy character.
Yeah, and the film series hasn't set the world on fire.
No, not at all.
People going, oh, that Species series.
I think she played, she stopped playing Syl after the second one.
Oh, okay.
I think that's it. And there's two more after that, Species 4, so yeah. Okay, Tiffany, played by Jennifer Tilly. This is Tiffany, as in the sidekick of Chucky in the later Chucky movies. Obviously, Jennifer Tilly does appear
in
the film originally before she gets transported into the doll body. Now, I'm not actually that familiar with Tiffany as a character overall because I haven't seen a lot of the later Chucky movies. I've seen Seed of Chucky and stuff like that. But I kind of put it in there because I think Jennifer Tilly is awesome.
Yeah.
I've seen her a lot of movies. I think she's a lot of fun. She's a great actor. And I think as well, when you had Chucky so iconic, to be able to try and create a character similar to him that could go alongside him and work, I do think Tiffany is quite memorable.
Yeah.
For me, it's interesting because not much more beyond that. She's only voicing it. But I'm a big fan of Jennifer Tilly's voice, obviously.
Yeah, I love her voice.
You know, so it's quite a good role. Mm. But yeah, she's such a unique woman. Mm. I think interesting.
Yeah, I'd go with that.
And I think...
And it's only kind of one of that type in our tier list as well.
Yeah, yeah. So. We're an interesting, we've got quite a few in there.
Again, one of them series where there's so many bits and pieces to it, it's going to weaken it a little bit.
Mm.
Kind of like the whole Danielle Harris thing. Oh, you're in 4 and 5.
Yeah.
Shrug shoulders. Like blank face.
Yeah, because she doesn't show up till Bride of Chucky, which is technically, you know, above, Charles Payton before.
Above the Descent, but not above
Neve Campbell.
Sydney.
Yeah. I'm fine with that. Which brings us to the last one.
Yeah.
It's Wendy Torrance, played by Shelley Duvall. Of course, The Shining. Stanley Kubrick's The Shining. What can we say about this character? As a character, she can be a bit of a wet blanket.
Mm.
But I don't mind it. I don't mind that aspect. Because here's the thing. You've got a very small amount of characters in this movie. And you kind of need this contrast of almost like she's married to Jack Torrance.
Yeah.
And it's not the happiest of marriages. They have a child together she loves and all that. And her sort of wet blanket, wet weekend kind of thing... means that it's easier for Jack to dominate her and stuff like that. You kind of get that aspect, you know?
I kind of feel more like she's taking us on board to support her husband.
Mm.
And then when it all starts going wrong, that's like that she's completely alone.
Yeah.
She's not even got she hasn't got the friendly Jack Torrance when he's not drinking to rely on. And she's got big old house to look after. It's her responsibility now. Danny's own issues. So I kind of get it, you know? I don't know if it's more of a weekend, more of just like, she's all on her own. Like she's got the whole isolation part is what scared me most about that film, and I thought it's her reacting to that isolation.
How about the latter part of the movie where basically all she's doing is crying?
I don't think that takes away from it. No,
neither do I.
I think so because it's just raw emotion. I know obviously the story is about Stanley Kubrick pretty much torturing the poor girl to get
Yeah, which we don't love.
We don't love.
Yeah.
That film's part of history now, so you can't kind of do much about that.
No, we can't do anything about that.
I think it's genuine, like, if you were in that situation, her face of, like, her husband is literally smashing through a bathroom door to kill her and her son.
Mm-hmm.
That reaction is amazing. Like, there is, like, it's just visceral. Like, she's not shouting, oh, stop, don't come. Like, she says stop, but, like, it's more her physical reaction rather than, like, silly, piffy lines that people say.
Yeah, when I think of her, I think of her backing up the stairs with a baseball bat.
Yeah.
And then eventually she does clock him. So there is that aspect that she's willing to fight back.
Yeah.
When pushed against the wall, like an animal almost. Corner certain animals, yeah, and they fight back.
Yeah, but it's difficult. It's not like she's going to go, oh, just slap you around the face.
Like, no, she pleads. She pleads at first and stuff like that. Yeah, of course she does. It is. I mean, Shelley Duvall is famous for two roles, and it's this and Olive Oil. From Popeye.
Oh, yeah.
The movie with Robin Williams. And it's, depending upon what you grew up with, it tends to lean towards what you remember her more for. It's this for me.
Yeah.
It is this for me. Iconic?
Yeah. Because...
I think so.
Yeah, because her role is a parent and a wife. And she's got, like, in other situations, the victim can run to other parts of civilization or... at least try to get somewhere. Literally, there is absolutely nothing.
We could also go as well to say this. Unlike a lot of horror movies that we've already mentioned here, when we're thinking of character, and we say, what do we think of The Shining when you think of The Shining?
Mm.
I don't think you necessarily narrow it down to one specific person here. Mm. I think, well, you can go, well, obviously, Jack Nicholson's Jack Torrance.
Yeah.
But I do think you think of Shelley Duvall's Wendy. I do think you think of the kid. I can't remember what his name is, Doc. The actor's name, I don't know the actor's name.
No.
You do think of almost them as a unit, a complete kind of thing, and I think that helps it as well. It's not like, oh my God, Jack Nicholson outshone them all. No. So we all know Jack Nicholson did a unique and clever interpretation of this character from King's book. But you also think, when you talk, you do think of her.
Yeah,
you know.
I just admire the fact that she wants to kind of do the best for her family. It involves doing. If someone said to you, oh, let's go live in this hotel for 3 months, I don't know if everyone would give up everything and up sticks and do it. I like that from the start, and the sort of introductory scenes and just her being like a normal mum and stuff like that. I really appreciate it. I know some people don't care for it.
I mean, as a movie, well, let's not get into the movie. Let's just stick to Wendy.
Yeah.
So iconic, I would actually put a bottom of iconic, though, because I think there's more layers to Annie Wilkes than there is Wendy Torrance.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that means we put a total of 5 in the iconic. Mm. Wendy Torrance, Andy Wilkes, Regan, Laurie Strode, and...
Ripley.
Yeah.
I just want to see if you remember that as well. I don't know. I say there's 2 Stephen King written characters in Iconic. It's quite interesting.
There's also an argument to say they maybe didn't play them exactly as they were written in the book either, you know?
I think they're quite true to the story, to where they're written in the book.
All right, we disagree on that. But yeah, I mean, majority ended up in interesting, and is there anything we'd move around? I mean, I'm happy enough
Yeah.
Yeah, nothing in the bad, really. It's 30 random ones. We'll revisit this in the future where we do another 30, and then eventually we'll get to the end and see if we can narrow down to who we think is the best.
Yeah,
do you still think Ripley deserves to be top?
Yeah.
Yeah, same here. Purely because although Laurie Strode's got more of an impact on me overall because of the Halloween franchise, I mean, there's the badassery of Ripley that puts her top in it.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you've got any thoughts, though, let us know in the comments. Thank you very much for watching. You can check us out on gbhbell.com as well as on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter and Tumblr. Go to Patreon to help us out over there. That's patreon.com/gbhbl as well as Big Cartel where you can find some of our merchandise. We have a podcast running on SoundCloud and Apple Podcasts. And of course, if you like this video, do us a favour, hit the subscribe button and help the channel grow. Games, horror and heavy metal. What else is life for?